Hello everyone, today I have come to discuss on William Blake's poem, London. Blake was born in 1757 and he lived through the period 1800s. So he was a witness to a very important phase in England. Industrialization was in progress, war was at the front, and these events had a huge impact on the lives of people. Besides, during those days of Blake, there were certain particular ideals which were supposed to be followed by the people. But Blake was a kind of non-conformist who preferred to differ from the ideals set by the society. So he was a kind of radical thinker. And if you look at his poems under Songs of Experience like Tiger, London, they are all on the flip side of the positive message that he has given in Songs of Innocence. If you look at the poem London, you will see that the ideas that Blake has and the way he prefers to differ from the ideals set by society is clearly depicted in this poem. Here, the poem is having four quatrains with alternate lines rhyming with each other. And what is important is the repetition feature is most striking, which also tries to show the horrors of the speaker. So this poem tries to depict the dark aspects of the society. It tries to show the negative side of the society and how it has control over others. So it is in a kind of response to industrial revolution. So where the society, it tries to show the failure of a society who, instead of building a society of joy, kindness, happiness, has actually bred sufferings, miseries, and woes of the people. So coming to the poem, we can see the very first lines is trying to reflect the condition of the place, condition of London. So the poem describes a walk through London. I wander through each chartered street, near where the chartered Thames does flow, and mark in every face I meet marks of weakness, marks of woe. So these lines set the setting and tone of the poem. Here the speaker is describing his surroundings as he takes a walk down the Thames River in London. So the word wander it's a very kind of confusion that speaker is not completely lost in the city, but rather he is not sure that whether he is lost or he is misguided when he looks at his surroundings. Further, he talks about chartered streets, chartered Thames. You see, concept like streets or river are free flowing in nature, but he is using the word chartered. That means he is talking of something confined, restricted, controlled. So his walks are not a kind of open or free in the fields. Rather, it is very much controlled and restricted. And this is also clearly visible in the passerby, where you can see that the tone of the speaker is melancholic, because the way he describes the sadness, the weariness, the melancholy look of the passerby, you can just imagine the situation around him. Next, he talks of in every cry of every man, in every infant's cry of fear, in every voice, in every band, the mind-forged manacles I hear. These lines are a kind of insight into the melancholy feelings of the speaker. You see, in these lines you can see that there is repetition of words, like in every cry of every man, in every infant's cry of fear, or in every voice. So this kind of repetition is tried to depict the shock of the speaker, or you can say that he is in a state of horror to see the surroundings around him, which is full of sufferings. There is despairing voice right from the infant crying to the crying of a full grown man. So he talks about the manacles, the mind forged manacles. So manacles are basically the shackles, or you can say they are chains. So mankind is bound to chains. So it is not physically bound to chains. He is trying to bring the metaphorical chained status of mankind. There is some sort of ban imposed on the actions, the thoughts on people, which is set by people's own ideas, by society and by the government itself. So it is a ban on people by the society's own set of ideas. Blake here is bringing the very thoughts and actions of the society under scrutiny, where the oppressed is unlikely to raise the voice against such ideals. Next he talks of how the chimney sweepers cry, every blackening church appalls, and the hapless soldier's sigh runs in blood down palace walls. See, earlier he has talked about his surroundings, which is completely filled with woes, sufferings, how the people are wearing a melancholic look, as if their walks, their every actions, their every thoughts are completely restricted, controlled by society, and even banned to certain extent. Here he is taking a dig in two important institutions at that phase of England, based on wealth and grandeur, that is church and palace. So here he is actually digging deeper into the reasons of such melancholic status of speaker. First of all, he is talking about church. Now, blackening church. You see, church is something which brings light and hope in people's life. But he is associating church with something black. Now, why this black? Perhaps he is trying to bring the hypocrisy of church. See, when you talk of chimney sweeper in these lines, you should recall his another poem named Chimney Sweeper, where we'll find that the children are mainly the chimney sweepers, and since they are small and lean and thin, it is easier for them to get down the chimney and clean it. And also, chimney sweepers are the poorest of the category. Even their life expectancy is very short. They are always sick and dirty. Still, they have to do this job so that they can provide for their families. And in this case, perhaps William Blake is referring to the children as chimney sweeper. See, at that time, church was responsible of orphaned children, but the chimney sweepers were mainly the orphaned children. So you can see he's trying to reveal the hypocrisy of church, that instead of taking care of them, they are actually appointing the innocent orphaned children to work such a dangerous job where their life is certainly shortened. And now he talks about the appalls. See, pall is something associated with the funeral of a premature death of children. Here, in this case, chimney sweepers are orphan children, and because they work in such dangerous condition, obviously their life is shortened. So leading a premature death. Now this is a appalling stage. That is, it has an abstract meaning of shock. So here he is actually trying to criticize the highly referred actions of church. Next, he talks of hapless soldiers. Now this is interesting. He is here criticizing the government. Soldiers are considered as the poor victims of government because they are sent to the war front so that people in the higher places live in comfort. So you can say that it is the soldiers who are spilling their blood, who are risking their lives so that people who are living regally, who are living at the higher places, live in peace and comfort. So when Blake is saying that the palace walls are filled with blood of soldiers, that means he is trying to imply metaphorically that it is because the soldiers are risking their lives at the front, giving their life at the front, so that the people at the higher class are able to live in peace and comfort. Next he says that, but most through midnight streets I hear how the youthful harlot's curse blasts the newborn infant's tear and blights with plagues the marriage years. This final stanza is very important. Perhaps it brings a closure to this entire theme of this play. Here, Blake is trying to focus on the poverty and corruption that the society has enforced on the lives of the people, where innocence is blasted, where innocence is killed by the perverted attacks. He's talking of youthful harlot. Perhaps harlot means a prostitute. So what he's trying to imply that a girl of such young age is forced into this profession of prostitution. Perhaps it is because of poverty or some misery that she has suffered, which has led her to live a life of prostitution, and further this has also impregnated her with a child. Now he is giving an ultimate attack on the society, where it is seen that instead of comforting the cries of her just newborn child, that harlot is actually cursing the baby. Perhaps here he is trying to show that how the heart of harlot is hardened as rock, and so does the heart of society, which is ignoring the woes, the melancholy, the sufferings of the people, and instead it is only running after wealth and grandeur. So the last line is really a masterstroke, where he talks that and blights with plagues the marriage years. So he's talking of blight and plague. So PL and blight, BL, both are plosive sound, which is in fact trying to intensify the horror of the speaker as he walks down the streets of London. Besides, he's talking of marriage years. This is very oxymoronic in nature. Years is not for wedding. Years is for funeral. So it is very strange that he's bringing these two together. That is marriage years. On one side, his marriage is for happiness, for some happiness, joyful event. Whereas funeral is a dark, sad, melancholic event. So you cannot join both. So when he's talking about marriage years, that means marriage at that time of Blake was a very sacred union. It was a holy communion where two souls came together, and basically when you say that they are married, they're also blessed with child. So here, if you go back to Harlot's case, you will see that Harlot is unmarried. So it is very ungodly act to have a child beyond marriage. So Harlot is having a child, but she is not married. So it is a kind of irony, or you can say he's trying to criticize the very marriage institution. So as we come to the end of the poem, we can find that from very beginning he has tried to criticize society, church, the palace. Even he has tried to criticize marriage and prostitution, and the themes that he has usually dealt: industrialization, materialism, poverty, and child labor is equally dealt in this poem. Thank you.